distribution a little bit later. Thank you. As to all the folks who shared their musical gifts in this way during the course of the church year. Wednesday evening, a reminder for Bible study participants that we are going to be going Zoom only, and I will be sending that connection information out early in the new week, so that the space is available downstairs for the November get-together of Celebration Club with Miss Laurie, which happens in the Sunday School room in person this coming Wednesday at 6:30. Next Saturday night, remember those clocks. Spring ahead, fall back in this case. Of course, this is the one, if you forget, it's really not so bad other than you show up embarrassingly early. But, you know, you just look like an eager beaver, hard-charging type person if that's the case. You at least don't look like an hour late, as happens in the spring if you forget. But next Saturday night is the change. And that leads into, as it does each year now, as we return to our new normal, to the chicken and waffles dinner. So you'll come the next morning, you'll be well rested from that extra hour of sleep. You'll also be really hungry because, you know, there's been a whole extra hour of time on the stomach clock. So you'll want to definitely, following worship, make your way right downstairs for the chicken and waffles dinner that is following right after worship. There is no cost. A free will offering, as always, is received. And all you really need to bring is that offering you might wish to give and your appetite. We will be doing an eat-in meal again, but there will be the option for takeout. So please don't hesitate if you would prefer simply to take the food along. Also next week, right after worship, the decorating committee is going to get together briefly somewhere there before the start of the meal, probably staying up here, I suppose, Louise, would that be right? So everybody heads down for the meal. The decorating committee is going to be smelling the good food, getting more and more hungry, so they'll be really ready. Do you have, no, I thought you were going to say something, Louise. Okay. So 11:15, right after worship, decorating committee, please stay behind. Always looking for new members. If you haven't taken part before, that is no problem. Would be wonderful to have you. With the new design and look of our church interior, there are some brand new ideas about how to do that decorating. So please come and find out about that next Sunday, right as the meal downstairs is getting ready to start. A week from tomorrow, so next Sunday, the day following, Monday, November 7, book discussion group, details are in the bulletin. Next Sunday afternoon is the first of the Jingle Elves practices. Miss Laurie, of course, has had that in her emails. It is also in her newsletter article for November. Details also here in the bulletin as they get back underway. And dartball is mentioned, which is a first in 2.5 years. If you've been around for a little while, you've probably at least heard of dartball. It's the goofiest sounding thing that, or one of the more goofy sounding things you're going to hear about. That was my reaction when I first heard about it, lo, these 22 years ago. But it really works. It's great fun. You throw darts, heavy darts, not like the ones that you might have in your house, but longer range darts. You throw them longer range at a chart, which is set up like a baseball diamond. And essentially, everything can happen to you in dartball that can happen when you play baseball. Plus one, you can stab yourself with a dart. As I foolishly did one time, trying to get them all organized in my hand, I tapped my leg and had immediately 5 little pinpricks of blood because they're very sharp. It's a lot of fun. There's great fellowship, low pressure. There's always snack food to be had. And we play either here at the church or at one of the other 4 congregations who are a part of the league. So if you want to know more, Larry Gehring or Mike Henninger would be the folks to talk with. It starts 2 weeks from tomorrow, first night here at the church. And again, highly suggest, if you've never given it a try but you wondered about it, perfect time. For one thing, it's a short season this year. Coming out of COVID, it's an abbreviated season. It will be a little bit shorter than the traditional time. So a good time to give it a whirl. Please note, I am still looking for those Holy Communion assistants. If you would be interested in being part of the schedule for that in 2023, please don't hesitate to let me know. Finally, in our prayers, Ann and I received in the mail from a friend in a neighboring synod the obituary for Pastor Delp, who was one of our predecessor pastors. Pastor Larry Delp served here from 1950 to 55, when he had to go temporarily on health leave. He died apparently on August 30, so I had not heard about that. I don't know if anyone else had, but we did receive the obituary, and it has all of the details. I have it downstairs in the foyer on the shelf next to the thermometer of Restoration 250. So if you would like to have a read of that, just stop by there. But Pastor Delp was the last living predecessor. So of the folks now pictured down in the hallway, I'm the only one still living, still not having shed this mortal coil. Like to keep it that way for a time yet. But anyway, we do certainly join with his family in marking his death. And as you read, you'll see, obviously, a life well-lived in the faith. And so joy, obviously, along with the sense of loss for his family. And then finally, Daryl Denlinger, as you heard, hopefully in my email this week, was discharged from community osteopathic. He and Janet immediately headed south, so they're now down there doing wedding planning. Diane Schell was discharged on Thursday, as had been planned, after her procedure, recovering at home. And Gene Weaver continues to make progress at the former polyclinic. There is now talk of plans for her discharge, though still nothing nailed down in that regard. So with that, we go over to Judy for our prelude this Reformation Sunday.
Thank you.
One of those signs of Pastor Delp's rich and long life, if you do the math, you come up with this, and that is he recently had celebrated his 70th anniversary of ordination, 70, which, again, the math works if you think back to the early 50s. But what an amazing testimony. That is a long time, seeing that he did not come here as a five-year-old. You know, it takes a few years to get ordained. So take a look at that obituary when you get a chance. And please stand now, if you would, as we join in the order for confession and forgiveness. You'll find that printed beginning on page 94 in the front section of our worship book. We gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us now confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with our opening hymn, 504.
Still figuring those page numbers out. We'll get there. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And we continue in song. Let us pray. Almighty God, gracious Lord, we thank you that your Holy Spirit renews the church in every age. Pour out your Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep us steadfast in your word. Protect and comfort us in times of trial. Defend us against all enemies of the gospel. And bestow on your church your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we joyfully interrupt the normal flow of things in our liturgy this Reformation Sunday morning, and that is to recognize four of our young members who recently completed First Holy Communion instruction, two sessions worth with me, and for three of whom, today marks their first receiving of Holy Communion. The fourth one, Brooklyn, has previously received in a former congregation, but completed the instruction for the first time, so we recognize her for that. So I'm going to ask them to come up as I call their names. We're presenting to each one of them a really fine study Bible, which is called the Spark Study Bible. It's the text of the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible, the same one that we use each Sunday morning in the Celebrate inserts. But in addition to the text of the Bible itself, all kinds of really great study helps, and some really great stickers in the back So Miss Laurie, I see her face lighting up with stickers, not to mention some really great maps. So we're going to call first on Brooklyn to come forward and receive her study Bible. And it comes with our love and congratulations, Brooklyn. And we'll have you just step right over there, please. Next, we're going to call on Derek Henry to come forward. And he is receiving the study Bible, plus, of course, in this case, his certificate of First Holy Communion, with our congratulations and love. Kyan Peters, I would like to have come on down, please. Kyan, congratulations and our love. You are welcome. And finally, but certainly not least, Bennett Troutman. And here he comes. And once again, congratulations and our love in God, Bennett. Let's have a round of applause for this great crew. We had a really nice time receiving, right, through our evenings together, and it was a joy, indeed, as it always is. They are great folks. We're so blessed with wonderful young people, which, of course, reflects the families and the parents and grandparents and aunts and uncles and Sunday school teachers and Miss Laurie and all the rest. Before you go anywhere, gang, I'm going to call on Louise to come, and we're taking our official picture simply because it's very hard to get people back together. Tell you what, let's have you step to the left, gang. Come on over here. Right, whoop. How about right about there? And I'll stand behind. If any family members would like to snap a photo, please feel free. We're just going to pause for a moment here as we do that. And I'm going to try not to break the camera. Shh. Cheese, you know, all those things. All right, we're good. Gang, congratulations. We will see you at the table just a little bit later. You can head back to your seats. And we'll continue now by going over to Jamie as she again joins us on Zoom this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The first reading is from Jeremiah, the 31st chapter, beginning with the 31st verse. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. Please join me in reading responsively from Psalm 46. For God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Though its waters rage and foam, and though the mountains tremble with its tumult.
There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High.
God is in the midst of the city, it shall not be shaken. God shall help it at the break of day.
The nations rage and the kingdoms shake. God speaks and the earth melts away.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. Behold the one who makes war to cease in all the world, who breaks the bow and shatters the spear and burns the shields with fire.
Be still, and know that I am God. I will exalt among the nations. I will exalt among the earth.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. The second reading comes from Romans, the 3rd chapter, beginning with the 19th verse. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human being will be justified in his sight by deeds prescribed by the law, for through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been disclosed, and it is attested by the law and the prophets, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction. Since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, they are now justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement by his blood, effective through faith. He did this to show his righteousness, because in his divine forbearance, he had passed over sins previously committed. It was to prove at the present time that he himself is righteous and that he is justified as the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of boasting? It is excluded. By what law? By that of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from works prescribed by the law. Here ends the second lesson.
Till our hearts are stirred. Alleluia, Lord, we sing for the good news that you bring.
With that good news coming to us this morning from the Gospel of John, the 8th chapter, glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." They answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The son has a place there forever. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed." This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. And Miss Laurie and the crew, anyone who would... It is my experience that we Christians are always struggling to find the faithful balance, the sweet spot, if you will, that is the perfect place in between two very important polarities. One of those, on the one hand, we want as faithful people to avoid falling into the trap that says, well, we've always done it that way, so why would we change it now? And so things become fossilized and rock hard. And folks who find themselves particularly convinced that this is a problem for the faithful often turn by way of biblical support to a short passage, for instance, in the Gospel of Mark, where Jesus says one day the following: "No one sews a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old cloak. Otherwise, the patch pulls away from it, the new from the old, and a worse tear is made. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins. Otherwise, the wine will burst the skins, and the wine is lost, and so are the skins. But one puts new wine into fresh wineskins." So, folks who lift up that text would say, see everybody, we've got to be ready to let go of the old, to not feel locked into the traditions and the practices of the past. We need to be ready to change to the new, because Jesus very clearly says the new wine he brings, the whole thing of Jesus, won't fit into the old stuff, the old ways, the old wineskins. So that's one polarity. But there is the other side of the equation, which is we strive to be faithful so that we don't just fall into the trap of trendiness, you know, just jumping on something because it's the latest thing, because somehow suddenly it's all the rage and everybody's doing it, and anybody who is anybody is doing it, and congregations that are successful are doing it. So we've got to always be ready to jump on board. And folks in who would say that we need to guard against changing willy-nilly, folks, and it's, sorry, I think I misspoke there. So the other polarity being, we don't just change for the sake of change, just because something is trendy and new. And there's scripture to cite there. The probably most favored place comes from the letter to the Ephesians, the fourth chapter. The apostle writing there says the following: we must no longer be children tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness in deceitful scheming. Using the image there of a sailing ship being blown without a rudder uncontrollably by winds coming from various directions, very clearly there's scriptural citation for standing our ground, for staying with what is traditional, what works, what we have received from those who have gone before us. Right there it is in the pages of Holy Scripture. So both are biblical. Very clearly, we have Jesus himself saying, be ready to toss the old out in the name of embracing the newness that Jesus brings, at the same time that we have the apostles saying, don't get yourselves all hepped up and just going hither and thither and into every new thing just because a new wind is blowing. You gotta stand fast like a ship with a rudder, stay on course as God intends. Both are biblical. And it's a really good reminder, by the way, that it's important as we study our Bibles, as we try to address any question by asking, what does the Bible say? What does God's written word have to say on this subject? It's an important reminder that we got to consider the whole, right? We can't just pick one and say, that's it. We have to consider the entirety of God's written word. And since both are a part of God's word, let go, move on. Don't let go willy-nilly and just do every new thing. Since both are there, our job is a very challenging one, which is, as I said to begin with, finding the sweet spot, finding the faithful balance, holding the tension of these two opposite poles with which we are called to live. And I bring that up this day of all days, Reformation Sunday, because Reformation Sunday and the Reformation movement of the past 500 years, beginning October 31st, Halloween Day, in the year 1517, with actions of our own Martin Luther, it really epitomizes the need that we have to hold the faithful balance of old and new. Because Martin Luther very clearly wanted to say in his time that the church around him had gotten so locked into all the old stuff, all the old ways, the old beliefs, the old patterns of living and doing, that it had become so fossilized, it had lost sight entirely of God's dynamic word in the Bible. And so he said very clearly, gang, it's time for new wineskins. But what happened, of course, was
among other things, that some people, in hearing his words, said, okay, out with everything that's old, literally, in many cases, then burning churches with all of their fancy artwork and sacred figures. There were folks who smashed stained glass windows and all the trappings of what had gone before, saying, see, look, we're supposed to start over and do something entirely different. And so you even had Christians who said, let us out. We are going in an entirely new direction. We're going to, instead of baptizing little ones, as is the tradition going back to biblical times, we're going to rebaptize as adults, and we're going to do this thing called believer's baptism. So you see, already in Martin Luther's time, there were people who really could not seem to hold the balance. Martin Luther made the comment about some of the more extreme people that it was as if they had swallowed the Holy Spirit, feathers and all, you know, as in the dove, right? That, you know, they had just taken it to this unfaithful extreme. And what Martin Luther and his followers said summed up what they were about and what our continuing mission is, this faithful balance. They used a Latin phrase, which sounds pretty cool when you hear it, ecclesia semper reformanda est, which sounds pretty cool. And it is pretty cool because what it says is the church is always in need of reform. Because we still constantly have trouble balancing it out. And so we still constantly tend to drift one direction or the other, getting all kind of caught up in what went before and resistant to important change in Jesus' name, and yet other times seemingly just tossing the baby out with the bathwater just because it's sort of a new and fancy thing, and we don't really ever seem to find the sweet spot. And so the fact is, as Martin Luther said already 500 years ago, we just got to always be ready to change and reform, because we never in this life, in this church, get to that exact right and faithful spot. And so the work goes on. And in closing, I would simply remind you that we have homework. That's always a question in confirmation class, you know, homework for next time. The endless question of students who are studying and learning anything. Well, we are students, and so we ourselves have homework, unending homework, in fact. And it is the task which has been handed off to us, lo, these 500 plus years by Martin Luther, but which goes back far, far beyond to God's word itself. And that is, it's my job and yours to work together to find the faithful balance, to hold the right tension of creativity and newness at the exact same time we don't lose really important stuff that has been handed down to us. You might think of the project here as kind of a microcosm of that, because it certainly would be right to say that the design team, in thinking about what ultimately became what you see here this morning, that was the balance that we were eager to hold, right? This beautiful historic building, at the same time tweaked, adjusted, changed, as we continue to move forward. So we got work to do. We got our marching orders, because it is our honor this day to follow in the footsteps of Jesus, of the Apostle Paul, of Martin Luther. Ecclesia semper reformanda est. The church, we, always in need of reform. Amen. I'd like to ask you please to join me in standing if you're able to do so, and turning to the words of the Nicene Creed. You'll find those on page 104 in the front part of the worship book. The words of the Nicene Creed serving as a sort of a primer of who we are and whose we are as the people of God. Good words to start with as we carry out our Reformation homework. Let's join together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And now in gratitude and humility, we join together in prayer on behalf of all of God's creation. God, our fortress, we pray for the church. Write your law of love on the hearts of your people, that we would remain steadfast in our witness to your grace. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. God, our liberator, we pray for your earth. Bring new life to overused land and contaminated rivers. Reform and reorient our relationship with the environment, that we faithfully care for all of your creation. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. God, our refuge and strength, we pray for the nations. Where they are in an uproar, bring wise leadership. Bring comfort for those in distress. Make wars to cease, and peace with justice to enter every land. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. God, our very present help in trouble, we pray for those in need of any kind. Show mercy to refugees and all fleeing from danger. Shelter any who are without homes. Calm all who are facing illness, surgery, or new diagnosis, especially lifting up as we do this morning, Cindy, Judy, Daryl, Timothy, Jane, Cora, Ronnie, Joyce, Ken, Donna, Diane, Jean, and these folks we now call by name before you, O God. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. God, our Redeemer, we pray for our congregational family. Bless those preparing for baptism and affirmation of baptism. Open their hearts to your Holy Spirit. Teach them your word. Give them courage to proclaim their faith. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. O God, you feed us. And so we pray this day as we gather at your table of love that you would bless Brooklyn, Derek, Kyan, and Bennett. May this be one day amongst many, many to come of sharing with your people at your banquet meal. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. God, our stronghold, we give thanks for those who have gone before us in faith, especially this day Martin Luther and all the reformers. Renew and reform us as we strive to continue in your word. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. With grateful hearts, we commend our spoken and silent prayers to you, O God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And you may be seated now for the offering. Let us pray. Holy God, gracious and merciful, you bring forth food from the earth and you nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts toward those who hunger in any way, that all may know your care. And prepare us now to feast on the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through the great shepherd of your flock, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who after his resurrection sent forth the apostles to preach the gospel and teach all nations, and promised to be with them and with us even to the end of the age. And so this Reformation Sunday, with all the reformers, with the glorious company of the apostles, with the choirs of angels and all the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, almighty and merciful God. You are most holy, and great is the majesty of your glory. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. We give you thanks for his coming into the world to fulfill for us your holy will and to accomplish all things for our salvation. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Remembering, therefore, his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, O Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people, and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, now and forever. And now, Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated as we join in singing the short hymn, Lamb of God. Please stand, if able to do so. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen us and keep us in his grace. Amen.
Full hearts and voices raise, tell everyone what God has done. Let all who seek the Lord rejoice and bear Christ's holy name. Send us with your promises and lead your people forth in joy. With shouts of thanksgiving, alleluia, alleluia.
Let us pray. O God, we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now may Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless us now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace, serve the Lord. We will. Thanks be to God.